Sarah Champion backstage at the fantastic 80s Festival Let's Rock London. Delighted to be joined by Mark then Jericho. How was your set? It looked like so much fun.
Thank you. It was very warm, hot and sweaty, which is how I like it. But yeah, you always kind of forget how much energy you get back from the crowds at these things, because everybody's up for it, which is lovely. And it's just tremendous crowd feedback. So you get halfway through and you think, oh, I need another wave of energy. And then everybody goes, hey! And you kind of get it all from the back. So it's got a lovely essence to it. And everybody's very positive here, so I enjoy it. And I love playing it.
They're so much fun, these festivals. It's all the hits. It's all the outfits.
You look out and see.
Well, yeah, but you know what I mean. And you look out, there's a sea of neon. And everyone is just loving it.
It's true, actually. Yeah, well, I told them to wear neon, actually. But it's it is funny because you see people with up the fright wigs and all the crazy stuff. And I think it's sort of evolved, this whole retro thing, into being rather than just a niche thing. I think everybody enjoys it now, because if you like their songs, it doesn't really matter who's singing them. I think it's what I like about it is that it's not trying to be cool, this festival.
No.
It's just about having fun.
Exactly.
Which is how I fit right in, because I'm so uncool.
Well, listen, you know, without
my legs look
without blowing our own trumpet too much, Absolute 80s recently voted the nation's favourite digital radio station.
Really? By whom? The nation.
The great nation. The great British public.
Well done, congratulations to Absolute 80s being voted the greatest, nation's greatest, I put my teeth in, digital radio station. I thoroughly agree, by the way.
What do you think it is about the 80s that made it such a halcyon decade for music?
Good question. A combination of things. I mean, I think it was the sort of emergence of freedom. The fact that people felt very, very restricted in the 70s, and there was a kind of, I suppose after punk, it loosened everything up. Mm. People felt they had a chance to do something new. But because there was so much restriction, I think, and control in the 70s, 60s and 70s, in the 80s, suddenly we had 24-hour TV. And I was on Night Network on Channel 4, which went to 3 in the morning.
Yeah.
You had things like that. You had a fourth television show. You had independent radio. You had this sort of explosion of street culture. And I think especially English street culture started to take over the world. And Britain started to be recognised for what it is, which is an artistic capital of the world. I think rather than being a sort of imperial, sort of nation of complete cutthroats, we were seen as being artistic contributors. But I just think there was a feeling at the time where anybody could achieve anything.
Yes.
Especially if you had a Filofax.
That was important.
I had a Filofax, just have one here.
I'm going to do a kind of 5 quick fire questions, and I don't want you to overthink these. I just want your
reaction.
Ready?
Aye. Can I talk about something in a minute? Now?
Yeah, of course you can. Best 80s song?
Best 80s song? Oh, I would say Scary Monsters by David Bowie.
Yes, okay. Best 80s album?
Oh, I was going to say the same thing. I don't know. I'd say I love Bowie. But I think probably The Big Area by Then Jericho.
Yeah, let's go with it.
Block.
Best 80s cultural moment?
Live Aid.
Yeah.
Without a question.
Yeah, a lot of people have said that.
Have they?
Best 80s sporting moment?
Oh, best 80s sport. Well, Manchester United winning for once for me. It was quite nice, actually. Alex Ferguson coming in, taking the club over. Yeah, I think for me, the revival of Manchester United and then becoming the force that they have subsequently ceased to become.
Best 80s TV show?
Oh, that's a really tricky one. The Tube.
Okay,
The Tube, because I love Jules, I loved Paula,
yes,
and it was fantastic. Gave us our first break.
I think that needs to really come back.
Well, things like that independent TV where you could do and say things where it wasn't all union restricted. And you had young bands, different bands, and people actually trying to change the face of music. But I must say, actually, best album of the 80s, I don't know. Anything by Echo and the Bunnymen.
Okay, we'll go with that. Across your, the many years that you've been working musician.
Bouncing around, yeah.
Yeah. What has been your biggest kind of pinch me is this actually happening moment?
Okay, good question, Sarah. I think headlining the Albert Hall was a major one. We did that for the Queen Mum, for the Royal Society of the Disabled, and that was kind of strange because I'm sitting there singing, not anti-royal songs, but songs about royalty and songs about society, and the Queen Mum's sitting there, smiling. So that was very nice, quite shocking. But then touring with Iggy Pop for me was the moment. We toured with Iggy and the Blah 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 album. I just sort of stood at the side of the stage. I've got terrible eyes. I had no idea what was going on. I was there. And the drummer said, "That's Iggy looking at me." Oh my God. And he used to watch me. And he said, "You're crazy, man. You're fucking crazy." He tells you that. So that was lovely. So probably that, I think, really. I mean, just playing live gigs, because to me it means so much playing live.
Yeah.
I think the final thing being working with Cozy Powell and Brian May. in the SAS band. He's standing there with two of your heroes and managing to not get laughed off the stage, which is quite good.
That's always good.
But meeting the heroes and actually getting to work with them and feeling you're accepted by them was a massive thing for me.
Yeah, because you know there's always a sort of classic thing of you should never meet your heroes, but when you do meet the heroes and they don't disappoint you.
Shouldn't introduce their wives, that's for sure.
Yeah, right. It's not good advice. That's good advice. On that note, are you sticking around today to meet some of the old gang?
Until some of the people whose wives have seduced catch up with me, I will certainly be here. I'll be selling t-shirts later, someone else's. Can I just mention one thing?
Yes, in fact, no, I heard we have an exclusive from you.
Is this true? Yep. I need my bit of paper for my lovely. Thank you very much, Greta. Right, okay. I've been a David Bowie fan since I was 10 years old, which is 45 years now. And in the wake of his death, everybody feels they want to do something, everybody wants to contribute, everybody wants to mourn. But it has become a little bit of a kind of a, I should put a gravy train to some degree, and everybody's kind of getting involved.
Right.
So I've stayed out the picture a little bit, and I was dropping everything on the floor. I have slippery trousers. I was hoping to do that. Thank you. I'm terrible. What is this? I was the music supervisor on a film called Golden Years for the last year or so. And as music supervisor, we decided to try and get the Bowie original. Couldn't afford it, because it's a British independent film. So I said, oh, man, I'll do a cover. So I did a cover of Golden Years by David Bowie. It had to be kind of a sound-alike. It had to sound like the original. Right. I used to try sounding like David Bowie. I thought I could for years, and then found out that I definitely can't. So I've done a different version. I've done my own version. The film's out now. It's called Golden Years. It's about pensioners robbing banks and the collapse of the pension system, so it's socially relevant. And I've done another version of the theme tune, which I'm going to be releasing soon. And I held back because I knew Bowie was not well. So during all this last year, I haven't been able to do anything with this track out of respect to him and his family, because they don't want things released, and I have tremendous admiration for all of them, for his management and his wife and his son and everybody around him. So I decided just to lay low a little bit on it and then probably release it in about 3 weeks time on the 13th of August at something which is called Bowie's Beckenham Odyssey. And in Beckenham, where Bowie sat on the bandstand in the town square and wrote the lyrics to Life on Mars, he also did something called a free festival with his lovely friend Mary. Mary's written a book about it, and it's 40 years to the day on the 13th of August. So a few of us are getting together. It's going to be rechristened by Bromley Council and Croydon Council as Bowie's Bandstand, and Bowie's Beckenham Odyssey will feature lots of top musicians, a free festival on the 13th in Beckenham, singing Bowie songs, and I'll be singing Golden Years. And the first 100 copies of it, the first 100 people to buy it, all the money goes to a charity, which I think should probably be a cancer charity in the light of David's passing. And we all love you, mate. Thanks for what you did for us. We miss you.